Hi everyone. I hope all of you have had a very good weekend. It's almost the end of the weekend now. And thank you so much for joining us here today. So you might know us, you might have heard of us. We are MedPrime Technologies. We are the manufacturers of a microscope brand called Silica that is basically a line of digital microscopes. Now, the reason why we decided to do this today is that, with coronavirus, with the pandemic, everything going online, everything going digital, there are so many new ways of doing things that have come up. You have meetings going online, you have ordering things going online, and a lot of people have expressed interest in doing microscopy also online, because earlier people who used to travel back and forth from their labs are not able to do so, are not confident enough to do so. So, there has been a lot of talk around these lines, telemedicine, telepathology. So being a digital microscopy company and, you know, understanding the space, we thought it is a good opportunity to, you know, have this seminar to actually have a conversation around the different ways that you can actually use your digital microscope, like whether you are, if you already have a microscope, if you're planning to purchase a microscope under the current circumstances, it's a good idea to, you know, be informed of what are the different things that you can do with it. And if you already have a digital microscope, are you really making the best use of it? Like, is there anything that you can do with it that you're not already aware of? So these are little things that we had in mind when we decided to do this webinar, and we've gotten a really good response, and we are happy that, you know, we have a chance to share all this information with you guys. So I'm not going to talk much about this anymore. Now let's just start with the presentation. So I'll start projecting the presentation now. Okay, so from our MedPrime team, two of us are going to be here. I'm Grishma, and I will be joined by Samrat also towards the end of the seminar. So both of us are directors and co-founders of this company. Now, what are we going to cover in the talk today? So first of all, why adopt digital microscopy? As in, what are the benefits? What are the different benefits that you can do? What are the different ways that you can use it in? That's the first topic. The second is, now, if you already have a microscope, or if you're going to purchase a microscope, what are the things that you need to keep a lookout for? The next one is, we will be very, as a manufacturer of microscopes, we'll just very briefly give a introduction of what our products are, what is the technology that we're using. And following that, we will be introducing our first panelist, Dr. Raghunath Narayanan Oni, who has been using Silica for quite some time now. So he is just going to share some of his experiences. Post that, we'll be moving on to the different features that you can do in a digital microscope. You have annotations, you have video recording, you have the ways, different ways you can share data. And talking about data sharing, we'll be talking to Dr. Rupesh as well, who has been doing virtual slide seminars with digital microscopes for quite some time now. After that, we will be moving into...
Sorry for interruption. I think your presentation is not working. Can you please represent it?
Okay. So after the talk with Dr. Rupesh, then we have two live demonstrations for you. So the first one is, like we said, we will be giving a live demonstration of our system, wherein we are going to be loading a sample onto our Silica microscope, which we are going to share live onto this conference. So and the last one is a hack that we had promised on our social media as well, that we are going to show you how, if you have a digital microscope, how you can use that system to do slide stitching. Because this is something that is very up and coming. A lot of people are interested in doing whole slide imaging now, but you know, really don't have access to a whole slide scanning system, or you know, these are quite expensive. So you know, if you have any interesting cases and you would like to try stitching a slide, so we will show you how you can do that using your own microscope and computer as well. So this is what we have planned today. So let's start. The first is, why adopt digital microscopy? So there are multiple reasons. Everyone has a different reason why they have shifted to digital. The first one, most common one, is to get an expert opinion. So I think this is something that a lot of people are already doing. That is, they capture images either using the, if they have a digital system, or they try to take a photo with their mobile phone, and then they sort of share it if they want a second opinion or a consultation. So this is one of the most common applications that everyone is using digital microscopy for, because it is so easy to share images on WhatsApp or just send it by email to get a response or a consultation. The second one that what people are using it for is for online discussions and seminars. You can actually share these images. So instead of like in schools or colleges, you have multi-head microscopes that people use to actually have slide seminars or to discuss it. But using, if you have a digital slide, if you have images of these slides, you can have that discussion with a much larger community, and you can have it virtually. So that is, again, one huge benefit of shifting to digital microscopy. The third one is evidence-based reporting. So there is also this upcoming trend where laboratories, especially if you have cases of, like, you know, malaria or some infectious diseases, they like to add a photograph of, you know, the diagnosis, or what the diagnosis is based upon, as a part of the report, as a part of brand building, as a part of sort of showing credibility. And also for, like, a quick second reference if the patient wants to get showed to someone else. So that's another reason where many labs are adopting evidence-based reporting. The fourth one, which is also a very important one, is actually health benefits. So a lot of microscopy users would agree that using the binocular microscopes over a long period of time leads to extreme stress in the neck. It affects the power of your eyes, it causes spondylitis, and it's actually it's bad for the posture as well. So that is one reason many young pathologists, and also some of the, you know, older ones, are now actually looking to digital microscopes to, you know, spare their bodies from that kind of pressure. And the fifth one is virtual library. Virtual library is like how you would say you would have a repository of unique cases. That this can be useful. It can be a study material for yourself. It can be like a college can build a study, a virtual library for their students, or it can be a community effort. So these unique cases, every time you come across it, you can actually capture these and record it for future use and teaching and training purposes. So virtual library is also a very important tool, and it's also something that you can do with the digital microscope. Now that we've covered that, now, if you are planning to buy a digital microscope, so how do you know which one to go for, right? What are the basic requirements? Because this is very common that there are a lot of options out there, and people try and go for what seems to them is the right option, but then they end up realizing that they cannot really use it for the purpose they purchased it for. So it's very important to, you know, purchase the right microscope for yourself. So I will quickly just go through the different varieties of digital microscopes. So when you talk about digital microscope, there are different concepts that are different technologies that are there. So I'll quickly just go through that. So the first one is the most common, most typical one, where you have a trinocular microscope with a C-mount camera. Now, this is the most widely used one. It's the oldest technology that is available. And what it has is, it has a camera that is fit onto the trinocular end. It's widely used for still photography. It is nowadays used for research purposes and, you know, AI-based algorithm developments. However, it is not used for reporting. Now, why it is not used for reporting? There are certain two main reasons. The first one is actually the field of view. So these C-mount cameras actually reduce the field of view greatly. So the area of the sample that you would see when you're looking through the binocular to the eyepiece is not what is captured on a screen while you're using this system. So there is actually a huge reduction in the field. So because of that, the user does not really get a holistic picture of the sample and has to go through multiple fields to cover the same area. The second one is actually more to do with the lag. So if you're looking at some of the cost-effective options, they usually have a lag to it. That is, the feed on the screen and that on the through the lens is not really in sync. So it takes a few seconds or microseconds to sort of reflect over there. And that, when you have to go through hundreds of fields, it becomes a big issue and causes a lot of delay. Now, this is a kind of technology in which you have a huge number of options. You have very cheap options to very really expensive ones that go into lags. And if you know what you're looking for, you can actually get a cost-effective, decent microscope in this technology. The second option that you have is a C-mount camera with a screen attached on it. Now, this is a similar thing. It has a camera that is fit onto the trinocular opening, but it is also like a mini computer that is attached to the top of it so that the sample visualization can happen on the screen itself. You can also capture images there and then later transfer it via USB or something. But the drawbacks are still the same with this kind of a system. That is, because the camera technology is the same, you are going to still have the drawbacks of like the digitizing, the lag, and also the reduction in the field of view. The third technology is what I think many of you would have tried to use yourself, which is a mobile or a tablet which is mounted onto a binocular microscope. Now, anyway, in a very crude version, this is when you try to focus your phone through the lens and sort of capture the images. But you do have, nowadays people are making adapters so that you can fit the mobile phone onto it. And you don't need to hold it by hand. But these adapters are still very unstable. You know, even in a micrometer level, movement can actually change the focus and the field. The another drawback that not many people realize with this is the load that it will create on your lenses and the head. Right, because the binocular head is not designed to carry a load. So if you're going to mount a phone or a tablet onto it, that is going to create an undue stress on your on the hinge of the binocular head, and hence that will eventually it's going to loosen the head and actually damage your microscope. So this is good for students or, you know, researchers if you want to have occasional capturing of images. But it is not really recommended for a regular routine use because it will damage your microscope. The fourth technology that you have is an inbuilt camera microscope. Now, this is available in some companies like Motic, where you have a camera and a computer that is inbuilt into the structure of the microscope. So the and you have options to connect it to a display screen. It can be a computer, it can be a tablet. There are even options to wirelessly project it if you want it to a projector or your mobile phone. So this is really a good technology, but as of now, it is the cost-wise, it's on the slightly higher side. Now, the fifth one, the one which we come under, is tablet-integrated digital microscopes. So tablet-integrated digital microscopes, what we mean is that here the image capturing or the image acquisition is happening via the phone or tablet camera. So the microscope is designed in such a way that the magnification happens in the microscope and it is then projected into the camera of a phone or a tablet. So in this, what happens, and because it is integrated into it, the phone tablet has a very stable structure, and the microscope itself is designed to hold, it designed in such a way that the phone or tablet is a part of it. So earlier, like what we said, the additional weight on the microscope or damage to the binocular head, those kind of issues do not occur in this. The advantage also, because of that, you have stable, repeatable and reproducible imaging because it's a very stable structure. And because it is a phone or a tablet, you have multiple modes of connectivity. The n number of ways you can transfer or data from your phone into another device. And because we are using mobiles and tablets, which are consumer products and are produced in large numbers, what happens is that the cost comes relatively lower as compared to buying a particularly a microscope camera as such. So these are the different kinds of equipments or instruments that you have that come under digital microscopes. Now, what are the things? So suppose you are planning to buy a digital microscope. What are the things that you need to watch out for? The first one, I think, which most people are aware of is obviously the camera resolution. Now, how is the camera resolution important? First, obviously, it determines how much of the details you are able to capture. The second one is this camera resolution becomes important when you have a digital zoom option. So the higher the megapixels, the more you will be able to zoom the image without causing a pixelation. So that is where it becomes important. And also while printing, the size of the megapixel of your camera determines how large a print you can take of the photograph. For instance, if you're looking at printing images for posters or, you know, large charts, you might want to go for a higher megapixel camera. Now, a recommendation is if you're going for a C-mount camera, microscopy camera, a 5 megapixel is a minimum. Because usually the field of view is smaller in these C-mount cameras. So 5 megapixel is more or less sufficient. If you're looking at a mobile phone, because these cover a larger field of view, you should at least go for an 8 megapixel or higher. And also for phones provide the option of a digital zoom. So if you want a good quality while zooming, you need at least an 8 megapixel camera. And it's not only about the megapixel, the quality of the sensor in both these cases also becomes important. For instance, for mobile phones, Sony camera sensors, the Samsung camera sensors. So these are all good camera sensors, which also is contribute to the quality of the image, ultimate image. The next thing that you need to look at is the field of view. The field of view is technically the how much area of the sample you are able to see in a single field. So in your binocular microscope, this is determined by what is called as your F number. Now, what happens is if many of the low-cost cameras, microscope cameras, if you see, they can cause up to a 75% reduction in field. Okay, so this is a specification that is not really mentioned with a microscope or a camera. So this is something that we recommend that you verify via getting a demonstration or you get a recommendation from someone trusted as to how much area are they actually able to show in a single field. Another factor that comes into play when you're talking about field of view is the reduction lens. So the reduction lens is an additional lens that is fit that comes with C-mount cameras, which determines how much is the field captured. So if it's a 0.5x reduction lens, that means you're going to get a larger field, but the magnification will be smaller. If you're looking at a 2x reduction lens, which means it is going to give a higher magnification, but a smaller field of view. So depending upon what is the nature of your C-mount camera and the sensor, and also what the application that you're looking at for, you might want to choose your reduction lens also accordingly. The fourth one is frames per second. So frames per second is very important if to get a smooth motion. So your eyes, our human eyes typically have a refresh frame rate of like 20 frames per second. So if it's more than 20 frames per second, we are able to see it as a smooth movement or a video. But if you have anything less than 20 FPS, you will be able to see the individual frames and it's not going to look like a smooth movement to you. So the higher the FPS, the more smooth motion you are going to get. Most phones come with at least 30 FPS cameras. And nowadays you have iPhones that go also up to 120 FPS. So the higher the FPS, the better imaging you will be able to get. The next one, which is also important, is the communication protocol. The communication protocol is actually the nature of the interaction between your camera and your computer or display device, right? So if your communication protocol is not ideal, it can cause a delay, like a lag in the camera field. It can also cause the loss of resolution, and it can also cause loss in frame rate. So these are all interconnected and sort of depend on your communication protocol. So the recommended communication protocols are MIPI CSI, which is what you have in your mobile phone cameras and tablets. The other option that you have in C-mount cameras is USB 3.0. So USB 3.0 supports high frame rates for microscope cameras. So at least go for USB 3.0. USB 2.0 will not give as good results. So you will have a significant lag if you go for USB 2.0. Screen resolution also, it's a pretty obvious one. So in here, what happens is no matter how high resolution camera you have, high quality microscope you have, if eventually the screen that you're going to be viewing it on is not of a high resolution, you are not going to get the same experience, right? So we suggest at least at 720 pixel resolution or 1080p, and LED screens are the most ideal for viewing microscopy samples. Finally, we have software. Right, so software, most microscope camera manufacturers are digital microscope manufacturers provide their own software. These software give additional features, like if you want to edit the images or you want to do color correction, you want to do micrometry, annotation. So all this is done using this software. But while purchasing the microscope, make sure to get the details about the availability and availability of the software, the pricing, and how long it's going to be valid, because many cases it does happen that the validity is not that long. So, and once the validity is over, you might have to pay again or, you know, get another software to do this. So do confirm that with the seller before purchasing. Finally, the cost. So what we have, the advice that we have for you is do not compromise on the specifications considering the cost, because decide the microscope based on what your requirement is, what your use case is, because otherwise you might just end up buying a microscope that does not fulfill your purpose. So according to our, what we suggest is that you need to budget at least 1.5 lakhs for a basic digital setup, which includes your microscope, camera, and your display, everything, to get a decent quality digital setup, because otherwise it's not going to be of much use. Okay, now coming to a little bit about silica microscopes. So silica is basically, the concept behind silica is, like we understood from all this, is that mobile technology has a lot of advantages, right? In terms of how much connectivity it has, in terms of high resolution cameras, there are so many advantages in microscopy, which we are trying to integrate with microscopy, mobile technology with microscopy. So that is what the concept of silica is. Now, what are the advantages that we are getting by using mobile technology? First is the circular field of view. So the reduction in field of view, which is the problem that happens while using CMOS cameras, does not happen in using mobile phones. You get a circular field of view, which is exactly the same as what you would see through the eyepiece. And because of the MISI protocol, there is actually no lag. It's like using your phone to take a photograph, right? So there is no camera, there is no lag. There's real-time focusing and sample positioning. There are N number of methods to connect and share data from your phone. And also, like I said earlier, the mobile phones being a consumer product are more cost-effective than microscope cameras. Now, in the silica range, we have multiple options. So we have a portable model, which is like something that you can carry around. It's a lightweight, handy system that can be taken anywhere. It's battery operated. We have benchtop models, which are more similar in structure to regular microscopes. And we also have upgradable binocular models. Now, upgradable binocular models are for all the students out there, MD, first year pathology students, who need a binocular microscope, but once, you know, they are starting up their labs or, you know, they are employed, they would like to go for a digital setup. So we have the option of upgrading these binocular microscopes itself into digital systems. So these are the binocular models that we have. And also our silica application has multiple features, like we can capture images and record videos. We have systematic data storage. You can create folders in patient ID wise or sample wise. We have image correction features. And also we have annotations and micrometry. Now that we have spoken about silica, I would hand over to Dr. Raghunath. So Dr. Raghunath has been a user of silica microscopes for more than a year now. And he would like to talk about how he has been using the system in his lab. I will just add Dr. Raghunath. Hold on. Yes, sir. Dr. Raghunath, you can start speaking now. Sir, your mic is on mute.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you, Grishma. Good evening to all listening to the doc. Yeah, it's not the best of times right now. I'm hoping everybody is fine. Coming to Silica, I've been using Silica for the past 1 year now, maybe more. I mean, like more than a year now. And you know, when Ms. Grishma asked me to come over and do this panel discussion, it reminds me of what we had to go through when we were deciding about buying the Silica microscope. So at that point of time, it was a risky decision because we were a startup and we didn't have a lot of peers who were experienced about the Silica microscope to give us opinion. But it was a great experience because right now we have three Silica microscopes in our lab and are planning to buy another one. So that's how impressed we are with it. And yeah, shifting from the binocular microscope to the Silica microscope, right now I'm doing all my reporting on a Silica microscope. And when I shifted over, the first thing that I found really interesting was the ease of using the microscope. You see, previously when we use the binocular microscope, either you get a good posture or you get a comfortable posture but lose your back. When you tend to get a good posture, it's something good for the long term, but it's very difficult because you have to sit uptight all the time. And after, you know, about half an hour to 1 hour, you need to take a break because you feel tired. You can always go into a comfortable position with a binocular microscope, but it's always going to kill your back. So in Silica, it's more like you can sit comfortably and just like watching a computer or looking into the TV, you can just comfortably look at the microscope and do your reporting. So that was one thing that actually led us into buying the microscope. And there are a host of advantages after that. And as Ms. Grishma had spoken, capturing the images were a great advantage. You see, when we started out, when we were in discussion with Silica to buy the microscope, we had started a new division which was doing research, you know, supporting research students and research scientists. So what we used to do is we used to study their images, which are primarily veterinary samples or in certain cases human samples, and provide our opinion on them. So what they all required was an image, and I had to capture these images using my camera on a binocular microscope. So this was an event which used to take about 10 to 15 minutes per image, or maybe half an hour depending on how things are. And then transferring the images are a really difficult task. But using Silica, we have been able to increase the number of images we give out. We have been able to increase the quality of images. And then it takes about 5 to 10 minutes. And I'm done with the whole set of 10 or 20 images that I have to take. So this has tremendously helped us with our research. We have a lot of clients now. We have clients, some clients from QSAT. We have clients from Oceanography Institute. We have clients from Qatar University. We have a client, we have clients from Amrita University. We have a lot of people who are really interested in our research because of the images and the quality of report that we give. So yeah, I mean, it's there on the screen now. You can see this was an image of the gill sample that we had taken from a fish. And there is another image of a liver sample in a fish. This is the sample of intestine in a rat. And this is a human sample of you know, renal biopsy in a patient with, I think, end-stage renal disease after IgA nephropathy. So these were some of the images that I had taken. So that had helped us tremendously there. And yeah, speaking of other advantages, you see, we are a standalone lab, and it's very important that our technicians are trained in identifying the quality of the slides before they reach me, so that it can actually make my process efficient. I don't have to waste time in seeing the quality and then going back to them. So having a Silica microscope, it's very easy to show your technicians as to what's the quality of the slide, what's the staining quality, how the slides are. And nowadays, they're able to do things on their own. They can decide the quality of the slide. So this tremendously improves my time in reporting. I don't have to go back with the slide because the quality is bad. And that's one advantage. And another thing is, when we get tumor cases, you know, measuring the distance of the tumor from the margins is, you know, is a relative process, because you use the vernier scale on the microscope and make a rough assessment of what is the distance. But with silica, this and silica's, I think Ms. Grishma is going to come into those, the micrometry, it's very easy. You just have to take the image, put a line across from the margin to the tumor, and then you get the most correct measurement of the distance from the margin. So, I mean, that helps when you have a structured report and a synoptic report, and it makes it pretty easy. So, yep, that's how silica has helped me. I have been using it for reporting. Even my colleagues here, Dr. Rohit, Dr. Timmy, they too use silica for reporting. And we had a lot of apprehensions when we started with silica, but right now we are using three and we are going for the fourth. So that's how I think about it. And yeah, thank you all.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir. So I will just go back to the presentation. Okay. Now, coming to annotations and micrometry. So micrometry is basically measuring microscopic features in a sample, right? So how it used to be done in traditional systems is that you would have a reticle which goes in your eyepiece, which will actually bring a kind of scale to your field of view. And you and then you would, whatever sample you would place on the stage, you would be able to see the scale on top of it. But there was an additional step where you would have to first use a stage micrometer. So a stage micrometer is like a glass slide which has minute markings on it of a certain known length, as you can see in the screen here. So basically what you would have to do is you would have this reticle on your eyepiece and you would have the stage micrometer on your screen, on your stage, and you would have to actually calibrate the reticle using the micrometer as to how much is each marking in the reticle corresponding to on the stage micrometer. And then you would change that and put the samples and use it to measure it. So this process is much more easier now in the digital system. There is just a one-time calibration that is required, which you can do using a calibration slide or a stage micrometer. These are available online, or you can contact your microscope vendor also to purchase these calibration slides. So you just need to put it on your microscope. The softwares are usually available with the cameras, or you even have free softwares available called ImageJ, which you can use to measure microscopic samples. So you just need to do the calibration once, and then you will be able to do the multiple measurements until you change the setting, or you know, the microscope is disassembled or something. So now in silica, like you said, so we have like different methods of measurement. So in the first one, you can see you can do a linear measurement if you want to do the length of something, or if you want to see the diameter of a cell or the depth of a tumor, you have a linear measurement that you can do. We also have circular measurements. So if you have like a large circular cell or a cyst, or if it could be like the inside of a tube. So if you want to see what is the area and the diameter of that, you can do that measurement. You can also measure an irregular area. So if you want something irregular and you want to mark out what is the perimeter of that, or what is the circumference you have, or the area, you can do that also. You also have the option to annotate if you want to put a label, if you want to capture images with like markings on it, pointing to something, indicating that this is, you know, an irregular cell, or this is something that needs to be noted, you can do that also. So all these are available in the application itself on silica. So while looking at the sample itself, you will be able to do all these measurements and capture the image along with the markings. Another very interesting application of digital microscopy is video recording. Now, where is video recording useful? So when you are capturing images using a digital microscope, each image is sort of limited to one field of view. So in cases where you want to do multiple fields of view, or if you have like a structured tissue, like, you know, like you have in histopathology, where you need to see the relative positioning of all the areas. So that is when, or if you want to go for like multiple magnifications, so that is where taking a video can actually become useful. You also have the option of, while recording the video, you can also have audio in the background where you're narrating the case history, or you want to describe the sample a bit, what you're looking at, you can do that also. So this actually becomes a really useful asset that you can share either for consultation or you can become study material for students. So there are, it's a very important tool. It's also, you can use it for motile samples, like you have sperms or worms, you have motile bacteria, you can actually record its movement using videos. So I was just an image here. So we had done this for a MapCon 1 year, where we had collaborated with one of the organizers to actually create a quiz. So their seminar quiz, their slide quiz, which they normally do via images, was 1 year done during using videos, where we had shared the case history and videos of different samples, and the students had to guess what the case was. So I have an example of a video that I will play for you. So this is a video that we have taken of a peripheral blood smear. And this is at 100x oil immersion. So we are going through different fields. You can also see that you can zoom in if you want to go into a bit more detail. So I have one more video for you, which is a sperm sample. This is taken at 40x. The next feature that digital microscopes have is data sharing. Now, whether you are using a microscope, a digital microscope with a microscope camera, or you're using a mobile phone, there are so many ways of sharing data nowadays. Now, which is the most effective method for you has to be determined based on your use case. So for instance, where do you share images and where do you share videos? So if you have homogeneous samples, like if you have a blood sample or urine, which is more or less homogeneous, and individual fields of view make sense, right? Or if you have, it's, you want to look for malaria or something like that. So those are the cases where you can send, pick multiple images and share images. But for structured tissues, like if you have histopath, if you have motile samples, videos make more sense because they will give a better sense of understanding to the viewer. Now, depending upon your use case. So if your use case is that you want to just, you found an interesting case and you just want to, capture a few images and share it. Or if you want like an instant opinion from someone, WhatsApp, Telegram, and email are good options. So WhatsApp and Telegram both have, whether you're using a camera computer connected to a computer or you're sending directly from your phone, both of these have web versions available. Email also can be sent from your computer. So these are very good options to get an instant reply for your case. Now, if your purpose is to actually have a digital backup of all the slides that you're capturing, so every case that you're capturing, if you want a digital backup, if you want someone else to access, look at all these cases and, sort of report on them one by one, backing up to a cloud server is also a good idea. So in Silica, we also have the option of sort of backing up or syncing data automatically onto a Google Drive account. It can be done with other systems also. And if you have a cloud server, like if your lab or your institute has their own cloud server, you can try and upload the information there as well. The third form is actually just sharing the screen. For the projecting the screen. So basically, you just if you just want to share the screen of your tablet as you're looking at the sample. So this is good for, again, it can be done from the computer, it can be done from your phones also. You can just use screen sharing apps like AnyDesk and TeamViewer, and people can just see the screen as you are looking at the sample. And the best option for seminars and study sessions is conference calls with screen sharing. So you have n number of apps nowadays. You have Zoom, you have Microsoft Teams, Google Meet, Geo Meet. So you can actually use all of these. You can either, if you're using a microscope camera, you can use the camera input to be streamed into the meeting. Or if you're using a phone, you can actually have the option of sharing your screen and by looking at the sample. So not only is the other person able to see your samples, they're also, you will also be able to have a conversation with them live. So that is, those are the different ways that you can share depending upon what your requirement is. So now we'll move on to Dr. Rupesh, who has been using these kind of sharing systems for his live virtual slide seminars. So I will hand over to Dr. Rupesh, who will just take you through his experience. Dr. Rupesh, your mic is, you have unmuted yourself now. Please go ahead.
Okay, thank you, Grishma. Obviously, the reason for which someone will go for trinocular microscope has been enlisted. And my reason for that, as I started to pursue histopathology as career, I came across many senior consultants who started to have neck problem, spondylosis, after few years of their practice. So I thought, let us make some arrangement to take care of this in early days of practice to avoid the problems later on. But as I started my search for trinocular microscope, the problems were same, like the cropped view. You will get almost 50% of crop view, and then there is no sync. There will always be lag between the screen view and in the eyepiece view. So then as I continued my search, then I could settle with Celica microscope. Then I purchased one in 2019, and now I'm using it quite regularly, even for the practice and even for this case sharing, and even I am also conducting the webinars. So after the purchase, I just use Celica as my personal microscope. Then what I did, I could project that over the bigger TV. And then as I projected that on the bigger TV, it just took out the eyepiece thing, and it was all the comfortable view on the screen. So I could do the routine reporting right on the screen. Then with the help of Celica, I could have some teleconsultation of the difficult cases, and then I could have the opinions from my distant colleagues. By that time, we just had an idea, which was very long awaited plan of creating a teaching platform. So as we are doing the teleconsultation, same way we were also conducting the webinars. And today we are successfully running a webinar series on Telegram. The group name is HistoLearn, with more than 100 participants, which are PGs, consultants, and even the faculties. We have already took some series of webinars, some 5 or 6 webinars, and we are also just continuing it. Why we started the webinar with Celica? Because you know, now in this pandemic, so many webinar series have been circulating by the many organizers. But you see, there are more like a theoretical thing. The speaker just clicks some photos, put in the PPT, and then speak too much of the theoretical thing. So the real slide view, which is the core of any histopathology learning, was really missing. So we started to have live slide screening session where we can show the slide like in a real time to all the participants, so that they have the full view of the case with their active participation. We can have case discussion, and it goes exactly like what slide seminars are conducted in the department. So this is the way we are using Celica for our webinars as a teaching platform. And now and we are also thinking to go one step further. HistoLearn, in collaboration with MedPrime, we are planning to build a completely digital platform where this whole slide image, the scanned images of the good teaching cases, will be uploaded for all the participants. They will have a good view of all the cases, all the scanned cases for some scheduled days. And later on, we will be having the webinars of that. So that will be the exact slide seminar, which we will be calling virtual slide seminar, as if it been conducted in a study room. And the advantage of that will be the cases will always be available for all participants to see it anytime and anywhere, so that even while they're learning or while they're reading, they can just go to the cases as a standard case and to learn all the features. So I believe, or we believe, that if that goes in execution, that will be the first Indian based initiative to have a completely digital platform for teaching. So thank you, Grishma, and thank you, Samrat.
Thank you so much, Dr. Rupesh. Go back to the presentation now. Okay, now we have a live demo. So what we're going to do is so Samrat, my colleague, is sitting, he's sitting at our office in Thane. He has a microscope next to him. And what we are going to do is we are going to live stream the video, the feed on the microscope, that is the screen on the microscope, with through this conference, so that as he moves the sample, as he operates the microscope, you will be able to see the feed as well.
Hello, Grishma. Hello, everyone.
Hi.
Can you see the?
Hold on. I will just. Okay, Samrat.
So can
share? I think you need to share your screen.
Okay. So can you see the screen now?
No, hold on.
Yes, your screen is visible.
Okay. So now, as you see, this is the iPad screen that we are using, that we have mounted on our microscope. And here we have our application that I'll start. And here. So let's start with the scanner view. Yeah, so this is a sample that you can see. I'll pan around so that you can see different field. This is 10x view. Then go for 40x also. So right now I have done a digital zoom. And on the right side of the screen, you can see different options for the annotation and annotation measurement and other area measurement, everything. So that's how you can like do the live streaming. Yeah, Grishma.
Okay, looks good, Samrat. We'll go back to the presentation. Now the final topic for today. The final topic for today is how to stitch images, how to do slide stitching yourself, right? So I know many people have always found this interesting, intriguing. They come across unique cases which they would like to, you know, save as a whole slide image for future, to share with people. We want to show you here how, if you have any kind of digital microscope, if you have a microscope camera with a C-mount, if you're capturing images with your mobile, if you have an integrated digital system, anyhow, if you have any way to capture images of a sample, how you can stitch them together to create a stitched image yourself. So there are three ways of doing this. This is done using the software called ICE, which is available online. So you can Google this and you can download it also. It's a very light software. There are three methods you can do. The first one is where you capture multiple fields, multiple images of the sample with a slight overlap. And you stitch the images, you capture these images together, upload it into a software, and you get a stitched image. The second one is if you are using a mobile phone or a tablet. So most of these, the inbuilt camera softwares have a feature called panorama. So using a panorama, although a panorama can be used just to stitch one line of images, but you can actually create multiple such lines and stitch them together to create, you know, recreate the entire area. The third option that you have is actually very interesting, is where you record a video of the image. You go through multiple areas of the sample while recording a video, and that video will then get converted into a stitched image. So I'm going to shift back to Samrat, who is going to show us how to do all three of these. Samrat, can you share your screen?
Yes. Yeah, can you see my screen?
Yes.
Okay. So let's start with making a folder, because whatever you'll capture, you're going to capture a multiple series of images. You have to put it in a folder, or like in different softwares, you'll have that option, or you can just capture this in your gallery and collect it together. So we'll start with another folder. So in this folder, I'm going to capture few fields from this sample. So I can just put down two. Now you have to take care of capturing image while one third. So you have to shift images in the form that there should be at least two third movement and one third overlap. So in that way, you have to keep capturing this, the area which you want. And after that, you can go back and see that all the images are here. And I'll explain how to transfer these images to your computer, and then you can the process of stitching also. And second thing, you can make a video of a certain area, and then you can create the panorama also. So here I'll start with the video. While making video, you also have to cover all the area you want to stitch. And slowly you have to move the slide. And also please take care of your focusing, so that the final image will be good. So this is how you can make video, and then you can go back. So in this stage two folder, we have all the images and video which we have to stitch. So what we can do, we can sync it with the cloud, or we can use our any USB cable to transfer the images to your computer. Now, the good thing is, like, we have already created another folder, similar folder, and here in Google Drive, you'll be able to see this test too, because test two is uploading just now. So only two images you can see, but there is another test one folder which we have captured, same field, but previously I have captured this. So we have to download this. So yeah, here I have downloaded all the images. And in this, you can see the video also. Now for stitching, you have to use a software called Image Composite Editor. It's a free software from Microsoft, and you can download it. And it's very simple process. You just have to press this new panorama from images, and you have to go to the folder which you want to stitch. Select all folder, open, and just press next. It will start its process. First process is alignment of the images. In this, it searches the overlapped area, and then it makes the composite image of complete image. So it, depending upon the number of images, it will take time. And then you can see the complete combined image. So just a second, it will. Yeah, here you can see all the images has been staged. And we can zoom and see the different section. Now the second step will be the cropping of the image. Here it will project the image into a plane, and then depending upon the requirement, you can crop the certain area from your staged image. So here it's not completely like captured properly, but while capturing, you can take care of that. And then you can move to the export section, where you have different format that you can select. So JPEG is a format where it will compress the images, and TIF images will, it will have a complete resolution. So you can select TIF, and then just you can export it to the same disk. Now I'll minimize this, and then we can go to the images. And here we'll have one. Binary image is default stitch. Yep, this one. Yeah. This is your image that you can directly share. It will take some time to get clear. You can pan around different area. Now the second step is to do the same thing for the video. So here on top, you can see there is option of new panorama from video that you have to select. Again, you have to select the video that we have captured. So here also you have to go for the next. It will analyze the video, then align the images, and then do the same process of like combining all the images together. And finally you can get the image. So because it's a video file and I have created a like a larger field, so it will take some time. But just for saving the time, I have already stitched that image, and that I'll show you. Yeah. So here I have made one mistake. So there is one certain area which is missing. And yeah, from here we can start seeing the details. So this is how you can do the normal stitching using Image Composite Editor. I'll just cancel this. The next thing you can do is you can make a panorama using Silica. For that, I'll just shift the screen to the iPad. For that, you have to go back and use a normal camera from here. And for making panorama, you just select the area. And here you have a pano option. And just you start this, and you have to move the sample. You have to move it slowly. Yeah. Now, good thing about this panorama is at once you are able to capture larger field. Now you can make multiple panoramas and do the same procedure. same procedure of stitching to get a larger field.
Okay, thank you so much, Samrat. So one thing we will be doing is these images and videos that we have shared, recorded, we will be sharing it via a Google Drive link with all the attendees, so that if you would like to try this at your end, trying the composite image composite editor software, you can do that also. So that's it actually for today. We really hope you have enjoyed or have at least learned something informative from today's session. And thank you to all of us for joining us. We have left our contact details on the screen. And if any of you have any question for us, do put it on the Q&A panel so we can answer them. One of you have asked if we will get a recording of the session. Yes, we will share a recording with you. If there is anything particular, any other detail that we discussed and you would like to know from us, do let us know. We can write to you. If you would like to have more such sessions, do let us know that as well. We would love to have more sessions. If there's anything that you would like us to explain, or you know, more hacks that we would like to you would like us to show, we would be more than happy to do that. But yeah, that's it. If nobody has any questions, I think we can sign off for today.
Should I share the link here itself, or will we share it separately?
We can share it separately. Okay. We will send an email. Anyway, we have to announce one lucky winner of a 50% discount coupon as well. So we will be picking from one of the attendees today who will be getting a 50% off on One Silica microscope. So we will be announcing that. We will be communicating that. We will be sharing all the discount vouchers for those who have brought a buddy with you. So so along with that, we will be sharing this as well. So thank you, everyone. I hope you've learned something today, and have a good evening, have a good night. Take care.
Thank you, Grishma.